Salut à Paris. Salut tout le monde. Hello together. My name is Andrea Frank and I work at the chair of Jörg Desel at the Fernuniversität in Hagen in Germany. I welcome you to the talk on the tool paper called Cyclone, a tool for determining stop transitions of Petri nets. The tool and the corresponding paper are developed in cooperation with Jörg Desel and Mark Findhammer. The talk is divided into four parts. First, I'd like to give a short introduction to the topic of the paper, especially what the tool is about. After that, I will explain the graphical user interface and then the functionality of the tool. I will give an outlook on future work. Finally, I'll mention miscellaneous things and further information.
First, we come to the motivation for this tool. Before we discuss the tool itself, we would like to consider what this tool was developed for. Its main functionality is to determine for a transition T of a Petri net whether T stops the net. A transition T stops the net, what does that mean? Roughly speaking, whatever marking we have reached, once we do not allow T to occur anymore, no other transition can occur infinitely often, so T eventually stops the behavior of the net. More precisely, a transition T stops a net if each reachable marking of the net enables only finite occurrence sequences without occurrences of T. We call such a transition a stop transition. The question whether or not a transition stops a net is relevant for several applications of Petri nets. For example, let's apply this question to a robot. Then we ask, can some component modeled by a particular transition be used as an off switch? Or in other words, does it allow a regulated shutdown process? The problem of stop transitions has originally been introduced and discussed by Jörg Desel in a previous paper. This paper, Can a single transition stop an entire Petri net? Was published in the context of ATA-ET 2019. Initially, I'd like to talk briefly about stop transitions of bounded nets. To determine stop transitions in bounded Petri nets is relatively simple. As an example, we consider this bounded Petri net, which contains a cycle. Of course, transition A does not stop the net. On the other hand, all transitions in the cycle, so B, C and D, are stop transitions. Algorithmically, we can examine the reachability graph for determining stop transitions in bounded nets. To determine stop transitions, the reachability graph only needs to be checked for cycles. T stops the net if and only if every cycle in the reachability graph contains T. But deciding whether or not a transition of an unbounded net is a stop transition is a more difficult task. Let's take a look at this unbounded Petri net. The net has two cycles, this one and this one. These two cycles look the same at first sight, but the behavior of the two cycles is apparently different. Let's take a closer look at this. First, focus on the left part of the net. The occurrence sequence AB can occur infinitely. Repeated firing of A and B leads to more and more tokens on the place P3. Therefore, this cycle has an increasing effect. By firing transition C, activity can be shifted to the other side of the Petri net. Now, let's look at the right part. Consider the cycle of this net with transitions D and E. Firing D and E results in fewer and fewer tokens on the place P3. So, this cycle has a decreasing effect. But how can this property be used for the determination of stop transitions? We consider transition A. If transition A would be forbidden at an arbitrary reachable marking, then there would no longer be such an infinite occurrence sequence. After activity was shifted to the right part of the Petri net, the occurrence sequence DE can only occur as often as there are tokens on the place P3. So, if we forbid transition A at any reachable marking, then the net terminates eventually. So A is a stop transition. Now we'd like to examine whether transition E is a stop transition. We immediately realize that if E is forbidden, initially the occurrence sequence AB can still occur infinitely and the net doesn't terminate. Therefore, the transition E does not represent a stop transition. But how we can identify stop transitions algorithmically? For this, let's look at a covariability graph corresponding to the Petri net. There are two cycles in the covariability graph, this one and this one, but there are no differences between these two cycles. Thus, examining the covariability graph for cycles does not yield a characterization of stop transitions in unbounded nets, as it is the case for cycles in reachability graphs of bounded nets. From the previous observations, we know that this cycle is decreasing, and this one is non-decreasing. Non-decreasing cycles can be arbitrarily repeated, whereas decreasing cycles will eventually come to an end. We generalize this observation to closed paths, which are paths starting and ending with the same node, but may pass through a node more than once. In order to be able to determine stop transitions, we have to search for non-decreasing closed paths. But these non-decreasing closed paths are not visible to the naked eye. This is where cyclone comes in. We summarize again and mention the definition of the term non-decreasing closed path. A transition stops the net if and only if there is no non-decreasing closed path of the covariability graph without an arc labeled by the transition's name. Non-decreasing is defined as follows. A closed path is called non-decreasing if, for every place of the net, at least as many tokens are added as are removed by the transitions at the arcs of the path. Hence, the effect of these transitions is non-negative for each place. Stop transitions cannot be determined by actual PetriNet tools. For this purpose, the tool Cyclone was developed at our chair. In addition to the algorithmic functionality to determine stop transitions of PetriNets, Cyclone can also illustrate and explain the computed results. Let me briefly list the functionalities of the tool Cyclone. The main functionality is the algorithm for determining stop transitions in PetriNets. Cyclone also provides a graphical user interface to represent the actual PetriNet, a corresponding covariability graph, and the computed results. Instead of single transitions, also multiple transitions can be examined. The computed results are clearly displayed and explained in a comprehensible manner. I would simply say, with this tool, the cyclic behavior of a PetriNet can be examined. In the next section, I'd like to give you a short overview of the graphical user interface. The main window of the tool is divided into four areas. The Petri nets that you want to examine must be in PNML file format. After opening a PNML file, the specified PetriNet is displayed in the upper left. Furthermore, Cyclone computes a coverability graph of the PetriNet and displays it in the window at the upper right. You can start the various calculations using the compute buttons. I will tell you more about this later. At this point, I would just like to show that the results of the computations are displayed in the lower area of the mainframe. Now we come to the core functionality of the program. Before that, this theorem has to be mentioned. There is a non-decreasing closed path of a coverability graph of a PetriNet if and only if, first, there is a solution of a system of inequalities, which I do not explain in detail here, and second, this solution generates a strongly connected subgraph of the coverability graph. The algorithm, which is implemented in our tool, determines stop transitions by identifying and processing non-decreasing closed paths in a coverability graph of the net. The algorithm involves constructing a homogeneous system of linear inequalities over the arcs of the coverability graph. It involves computing a basis of solutions, and it involves performing a divide and conquer approach on these solutions to find subsets of basis solutions generating strongly connected subgraphs. Below, I'd like to go into the visualization of the computed basis solutions. It was not easy to find an example in which a solution of the system of inequalities exists, which corresponds to a subgraph of the coverability graph that is not strongly connected. In the following example, we succeeded. It seems that the transitions A and B form a behavioral cycle. But depending on whether D or E occurs first in this PetriNet, either only the left or only the right side of the net is activated. Transition A, considered alone, is not non-decreasing. B by itself is not non-decreasing too. But if you look at A and B together, they are non-decreasing. But both A and B are not strongly connected. There's no such occurrence sequence. Cyclone identifies these situations and illustrates them to the user. For this, first choose transition C to determine whether C stops the net. In this case, the algorithm determines exactly one basis solution. It consists of the edges A8 and A10, which correspond to the transitions A and B. The result is also displayed in the output area with a list of basis solutions. You can also display the basis solution graphically in the coverability graph. To do this, click the basis solution in the list. By the way, at the same time, the corresponding transitions in the PetriNet are also highlighted by color. Cyclone recognizes that there are two cycles in the coverability graph, but that the corresponding basis solution is not strongly connected. And since there is only one basis solution, combinations of basis solutions to obtain a strongly connected subgraph are not possible. Consequently, there is no non-decreasing closed path. As a result, C stops the net. We extend the example by the transitions F and G, which act like a swing. With the new transitions, the outer token can be moved from P2 to P3 and vice versa. This means that now A and B can occur alternatingly, but not without occurrences of F and G. Cyclone computes three basis solutions. In addition to the basis solution from above, Cyclone computes two further basis solutions, each of which strongly connected. Consequently, C does not stop the net. An additional functionality of the tool is that it can examine whether a transition stops a subnet. A subnet can be selected in Cyclone by using the Shift key together with the mouse. The corresponding transitions are then marked with an OR. In this example, the two transitions A and B generate the subnet. The result is the same set of basis solutions. Now the question is it possible to combine the basis solutions to form a strongly connected path containing A or B? The tool searches for such combinations and displays them directly in the list of basis solutions as well as in the coverability graph. We are leaning towards the end of this presentation. However, I'd like to give a brief outlook on planned extensions of the tool. A possible improvement would be to replace the current non-deterministic construction algorithm for a coverability graph, which we took from a library, by a more deterministic one. Then, each repeated computation of the coverability graph would result in the same graph structure and consequently in the same numbering of arcs. We are also considering restricting the coverability graph to the minimal coverability graph. The advantage is that the minimal coverability graph is on the one hand smaller and on the other hand also unique. At the end of this presentation, some miscellaneous information follows. If you want to use Cyclone, you can download the tool from our website. It's freely available. The tool was developed with Java and therefore it is system independent on Windows, Linux and Mac systems. All you need to do is unzip the file and Cyclone is ready to run. Various examples are also included and can be opened immediately using shortcuts. We invite you to have a look at our tool demonstration, which is offered in another video as part of this year's PetriNet conference. We also invite you to participate in the discussion on our publication. Due to the COVID-19 pandemic, also this event will be held virtually. Our talk will take place on Thursday, June 25, from 2:30 to 3:00. Please check the conference website for more information. Thank you all very much for taking the time to follow this presentation. I hope to see you in Paris next year. Stay healthy. Bye.